Well, good morning, everybody. My name is Klaus Schmeh. Welcome to my presentation. I'm going to talk about post-quantum cryptography, and I'm going to try to explain post-quantum cryptography with cartoons. And for this purpose, I have invited a couple of guests. And, well, for the beginning, let me introduce my first guest. Please welcome, well, a quantum computer. Well, that's a little surprising. But what is a quantum computer anyway? Well, a quantum computer looks a little different from the computers you and I usually use in our daily work. This is because a quantum computer is based on quantum mechanics. And the most or the best known concept in quantum mechanics is Schrödinger's cat. Most of you certainly know that Schrödinger's cat can be dead and alive at the same time, but only until the moment when you look at this cat. So it has two states, and at the moment when you look at it, one of the states gets lost and only the other one survives. And this is very similar to the way a quantum bit works. A quantum bit can be 0 and 1 at the same time, but only until the moment when you look at it, which means only until the moment when you perform a read access, if you read out this quantum bit. And if we look at a byte register of a quantum computer, which consists, of course, of 8 quantum bits, such a byte register can have 256 values at the same time, but only one of these values can finally be read out. This is always the case in quantum mechanics or in quantum computers. So now the question is, what is a quantum computer good at? Well, it's good at executing extremely many computations in parallel, but only if there is only one result. Because as I said, most of what's going on here is lost until the at the moment when you look at the value or of the content of a quantum register, everything but one state gets lost. And this is why a quantum computer is pretty good at doing many things at the same time if there is only one result. Examples include finding an element in a large set or finding an optimal solution if many solutions exist. And what is a quantum computer not good at? Well, for example, sorting. Why sorting? Because if you sort the elements in a field, you need more than just one result, because basically the whole set is the result with all the ordered elements. And this is what a quantum computer is absolutely not good at. And so sorting has more than one result, and this is not a first choice for a quantum computer. And what is a quantum computer particularly good at? Well, at prime factorization. Well, we are here at the RSA conference, so probably most of you know what prime factorization is. I'm going to explain it briefly anyway. You certainly know prime multiplication. This means we have two prime numbers, in this case 17 and 23. These numbers, if we multiply them, that's a pretty simple process. Can be efficiently implemented in just about any computer. But if we are talking about the reverse process, the prime factorization, this is far from trivial. You can try to factorize 377. That's not that easy. Well, of course, it can be done, but in practice, we are dealing with much longer, much higher numbers. So this is also called a one-way function, simple to compute, but very difficult to do it in the opposite direction. And as you know, RSA, and I'm not talking about the conference, of course, I'm talking about the crypto system, RSA is closely related to prime factorization, because if Alice uses it, she uses two prime numbers as her private key and the prime number product as her public key. And in practice, of course, the prime numbers are a little higher. We have, for example, prime numbers consisting of 1024 bits, and the public key, well, not really the prime numbers, but the public key then has a length of 2048 bits. And as a quantum computer is quite good at breaking or at factorizing, it can be used to break RSA, and it can even break RSA within seconds, well, up to a key length of about 5 bit at the moment, which is not very much considering that we deal with 2048 bit in practice. But, well, future versions might be a lot more powerful. So, thank you for coming, Mr. Quantum Computer. So, before I come to my next guest, let me introduce myself. Well, my name is Klaus Schmeh, as I said, and I work for a company named Cryptovision, located in Germany, in Gelsenkirchen, Germany. We specialize in modern, user-friendly cryptography and secure electronic identities. If you want to know more, just come to our booth, number 5671G at the German Pavilion, and my colleagues and I will be happy to tell you a little more about us. My name is Klaus Schmeh. I'm the chief marketing editor, so I'm in the marketing department. So my job is to give presentations like these. And I've written a couple of books. But most of them are in German, unfortunately. But the next one will be in English. It will be published in September. Okay, let's come back to quantum computers. A quantum computer can break RSA and other crypto systems pretty efficiently, as I mentioned. So we need to look at alternative crypto systems. And at the moment, mainly six families that are believed to be quantum secure, quantum computer proof exist. One of them is the lattice-based encryption system family. Then there are the so-called code-based encryption systems, hash-based encryption systems, non-commutative systems, multivariate systems, and isogeny-based systems. None of these systems is in widespread use today. This might change in the near future, or maybe it even has to change if quantum computers become more powerful. And, well, I can't explain all of these, so we have to limit ourselves to the three top ones. I'm going to look at these in a little more detail. But before that, let me mention that a post-quantum computer standardization competition is going on at the moment. It's hosted by the US authority NIST, and 69 algorithms were submitted to this competition, which is quite a lot. Meanwhile, we are in round two, and meanwhile, 43 sorry, of them have been kicked out, mainly for security reasons. And this means that 26 algorithms are still in the race. And, well, I will come back to this competition later. But it's important to know that standardization is going on at the moment. And now let's welcome our next guest. My next guest is a pretty slow one. It's a snail. So welcome, Mr. Snail. Well, I asked Mr. Snail, can you explain lattice-based crypto to us? And Mr. Snail said, yes, I can even explain lattice-based crypto to you. And this is what we are going to look at now. So lattice is the more mathematical term. A snail would call this a lattice field. So a lattice and a lattice field is the same in our case. And how is a lattice or a lattice field defined? Well, it's defined as a set of intersection points in the space. And these points are defined by parallel and equidistant lines going in two directions, at least in the two-dimensional case. And this is the two-dimensional space. Imagine having parallels going in two directions and being equidistant and intersecting each other. And each intersection point is called a lattice point in mathematics and simply a lattice in snail speak. To define a lattice field, we need two vectors. the so-called base vectors. And the interesting, or the one interesting about, thing about this is that different bases can be used to define the same lattice field. For example, on the left side, you see two base vectors that are almost orthogonal to each other. This is also called a good base. And on the right side, you see the red vectors. They are almost parallel. And this is also referred to as a bad base. So there are always good bases and bad bases to define exactly the same lattice field. And now we come to the snail lattice problem. This is this can be explained if we place a snail somewhere in the lattice field and, well, the snail is hungry. It needs to get to the closest lattice. And it really needs to be the closest lattice because the snail is slow. If it's not the closest lattice, it might starve to death before it has even reached the lattice. And now the question is, which lattice is the closest one from the point of view of the snail? Which lattice is closest? Well, this is pretty easy to answer if we are in the two-dimensional space. But of course, well, while snails mainly stay in the two-dimensional space, mathematicians prefer higher dimensions, for example, the 250-dimensional space. And I can tell you that in 250 dimensions, it's extremely difficult to find the closest lattice unless one has a good base. So it's easy if you have a good base of this 250-dimensional lattice field. If you only have a bad base that defines the same lattice field, it's difficult. And this is a concept that is very important for lattice-based crypto systems. Now let's look at our first crypto system today, a lattice-based crypto system named Goldreach, Goldwasser, Halevi, also known as GGH. And GGH is based on a lattice field, like you can see it here. And Alice's private key is a good base defining this lattice field. And her public key is a bad base defining this, defining the same lattice field. And now, if Bob wants to encrypt something for Alice, he places a snail somewhere in the lattice field. We are in the 250-dimensional space, so we have 250 components to encode the message, and that should be enough to encode, for example, an AES key. So encoding the message is not really difficult, but can Alice decode it? And the answer is yes, because she has a good base. And as I said, with a good base, it's pretty simple to find the closest lattice. And then she knows where the snail is, where the lattice is, and she can derive the vector and decode the message. And for everybody else, for an attacker, it's difficult because the attacker has only the bad base available. And this is how GGH works. Now the question is GGH quantum proof? Answer is yes. But is it also secure? And the answer is no, it has been broken. It has been broken with a method that has got nothing to do with quantum computers. So it's not really a method that will be used in practice. But, well, there are other lattice-based methods that are still believed to be secure. And, well, maybe we will see one of them used in practice in the near future. Well, let's now look at one of these lattice-based methods that is still considered secure, or the whole family, so it's a subfamily. We have been talking about lattice-based methods now. Now we are talking about a subfamily of the lattice-based methods, the so-called learning with errors methods. And as you will see now, at first view, these LWE systems have got nothing to do with lattices. But so I will explain them first, and then I will tell you what the relationship between these LWE systems and lattices is. But to explain them, we don't need a lattice, but we need an equation system. You probably know this from high school or from university, nothing really spectacular. We have an equation system with three variables and three equations, and we can solve this with Gaussian elimination. And we can also do this with modular arithmetics. So if you're a little familiar with public key cryptography and if you have things like that, you know modular arithmetics. And the way to solve such a system is exactly the same with Gaussian elimination. And now we are going to add a few more equations. And now we have only 3 variables, but 8 equations. This is also called an overdefined equation system. And what happens if an equation system is overdefined in general? Well, it's unsolvable in general, but not in this case, because in this case or in the following, I will always use an overdefined equation system that is solvable. I have chosen it in a way that is, it is always solvable. And in this case, the solution is x equals 3, y equals 7, z equals 6. And can easily be checked that this solution works. And now we're going to do something you have probably never done at high school or even at university. We are going to add errors on the right side of the system. For example, we add 1 here, we subtract 2 here, we don't change the next one. And as you see here, all these errors are small compared to the modulus. The modulus is almost 800. All these errors are 1, 2, or 0. So we have pretty small errors. And now we are going to hide these errors. So we don't write 38 plus 1. We only write 39. And we don't write 462. Instead, we write 460 and so on. And now all these errors are not visible anymore. And now there's an interesting question, the so-called learning with errors problem. The question is, can the error still be found without knowing x, y, and z? Of course, if we know x, y, and z, it's trivial because we just put in x, y, and z into one of these or into these equations, and then we easily see the error. But can it also be done if we don't know x, y, and z? And the answer is yes, it can be done, but it's laborious. And this leads us to our next, first of all, it leads us to a trapdoor function. That means it's a function that is easy to compute, but it's difficult to invert unless one has additional information. And this is the so-called learning with errors trapdoor function. It is clear that adding errors to such an equation system is pretty trivial. We just need to add small numbers. But the reverse process, finding errors in this equation system, is difficult unless we know x, y, and z. And this can be used to define another asymmetric encryption system, the so-called REGEF encryption. In this case, Alice's private key is the solution of an equation system. It's the one we have already seen. And her public key is the equation system itself with incorrect solutions. So we have errors on the right side, small errors, and this is Alice's public key. And if Bob wants to encrypt something, he, well, first of all, he needs to toss a coin for every equation. In this case, he needs to toss the coin 8 times. And now he keeps the head equations. These are 3 equations in this case, and he kicks out the others. So this is, of course, a random process, and in general, about half of the equations remain, and the other half is dropped. And now he adds these equations, and as you know from Gaussian elimination, this can be done without changing the solution. And then he takes the added equations, and now he can use this to encrypt 1 bit. It's only 1 bit, not much, but it's a public key system. Well, to encrypt 0, he adds a small error to the result. Well, the result is 717. A small error would be 1, for example. This is what he does here. He makes, he adds 1, gets 718, and this is the equivalent of the number 0. And if he wants to encode a 1, he adds a large or a big error. In this case, the modulus is almost 800, so 400 would be the maximum error he could add, and this is why he receives 319 instead of 770. So you can check this 770 plus 400 is about 319 with a small error. But so we have a big error in the left case and a small error in the left case and a big error in the right case. And this is how one bit is encoded. And Alice, who knows X, Y, and Z, can easily check if the error is big and small. And well, if the error is small, it's a zero. If it's big, it's a one. And for an attacker, this is very difficult to decrypt because he needs to invert the learning with errors trapdoor function, which is difficult. So now you might say, well, this is a nice algorithm, but it's a lot of work for just encrypting one bit, and this is correct, but there are more effective or more efficient variants of LWE. I can't go into detail about that, but the general concept should have become clear now, and it's easily possible, or it's possible to make it more efficient. And what has REGEF got to do with lattices or whatever you want? Well, it's as you can see here, each column in this equation system can be interpreted as a vector. So this is equivalent to a three-dimensional vector field. And of course, in practice, we don't have three dimensions, but 250 or something like that. And each column can be identified with a vector. And encryption in this case means putting a snail close to a lattice is a zero. Looking for a maximum distance from the next lattice is a one. And Alice can easily decrypt this with her knowledge or her private key, and an attacker needs to solve the snail lattice problem, which is difficult. And are there lattice-based methods in the NIST competition? The answer is yes. 12 of them are left. And these systems have names like NTRU, New Hope, Three Bears, FrodoChem, and a few others. So maybe we will see a few of these systems among the winners of the competition. So thank you, Mr. Snail. And now I'm going to introduce my next guest. My next guest is a rocket scientist. And this Dr. Rocket Scientist will explain code-based cryptography to us. And she says, this isn't rocket science, which is basically true. But we need to look at error-correcting codes first. To do so, we assume that we have a spaceship traveling from the Earth to outer space. And of course, this spaceship sends messages back to the base station on Earth. And well, of course, this is done in a digital way. But due to the long distance, it can easily happen that an error occurs. For example, a zero might become a one or something like that. And the question is, how can we avoid this? Well, we can use parity bits. You certainly know the concept of parity bits. Just take 7 bits, add an 8th one such that the number of ones is even in each byte. Well, no concept. We could also do something else. We could use a 3x code. That means every information is sent 3 times in a row. This is also a code that will, or a method that will work to find errors. And if we compare these two methods, the parity bits are an error detecting code because we can tell if something is wrong. We don't know where exactly the error is, but we know that an error exists if the number of ones isn't even. The 3x code is even better. It's an error correcting code because we can use it even to locate the error and correct it. So the 3x code is quite nice, but it's not very efficient, of course, because sending each information 3 times in a row is, of course, a waste of bandwidth. And so we need to look for something better. And, well, linear error correcting codes are a very good alternative. What is a linear error correcting code? Well, if the spaceship transmits a 5-bit word, let's say, this 5-bit word, before it gets transmitted, is multiplied with a matrix. In this case, with a 5x9 matrix, so we get a 9-bit word as a result. And this 9-bit word is transmitted. So 5 bits are extended to 9 bits. As you can see here, 5 bits to 9 bits, this means we have an overhead of 4 bits. And it can be proven, this is not something I'm going to do today, but it can be proven that 2 errors can be corrected in such a scheme. Or if you take another linear error correcting code, in this case we have 4 bits extended to 10 bits, we have an overhead of 6 bits, and in this case, 3 errors can be corrected. You have to believe me, this is nothing I can prove now, but this is how it is done in coding theory. In general, the rule is, if we have an overhead of n bits, n by 2 bits can be corrected. And this is a very important fact, that is one of the basic facts in coding theory. And now you might say, well, this sounds good, but how does this error correction work? And this is, again, something you have to believe me, I can't do it right now, but there are error correcting algorithms that can be used in this particular case. So if a spaceship sends a 5-bit word or wants to send a 5-bit word, it first applies this matrix multiplication, then it gets, for example, what do we have here, a 7-bit word. Then this result is transmitted to the base station on Earth. We assume that there are a few errors, and the people on Earth will use this error correction, sorry, it's not detection, but correction, an error correction algorithm, and so the errors are eliminated, and then a backwards matrix multiplication takes place, and we get the original 5-bit word. Again, this is how the communication works, or not really the communication, the transmission. All this has got nothing to do with cryptography, but now we are getting closer to it. The problem here is that this error correction algorithm is inefficient. It can take a long time to find these errors, especially if we're dealing with long sequences of bits. And this is usually the case, but there are exceptions. If we choose the matrix properly, it's a lot faster. So in general, error correction is very laborious. If we take especially chosen matrices, it's fast, or to say it in a different way, this matrix multiplication, many different matrices can be used for these purposes. Some allow for efficient error correction, most of them don't. So we have good matrices and bad matrices. The good ones allow for fast error correction, but they are only a minority. So just like in life, good things can always be turned into bad things very easily. This is also the case here. A good matrix can be turned into a bad one just by multiplying it with 2 so-called blend matrices. And the result of this multiplication is a bad matrix. We can easily turn a good one into a bad one. And this can be used for encryption. So we finally have arrived at cryptology. This can be used for McAlice encryption. Alice's private key consists of these 3 matrices, a good matrix and 2 blend matrices, and the public key is the bad matrix. And if we compare this with RSA, the private key of RSA consists of 2 prime numbers, the public key consists of the product, and in McAlice, we have these matrices which form the private key, and the public key is the product. It's somehow similar. And how does McAlice encryption work? Well, the plaintext is a sequence of bits. It's multiplied, Bob multiplies it with Alice's public key. Then he gets an extended version of this plaintext, and then he adds errors. These errors are just random numbers. But this is important, this is the encryption process, and then he sends the result as the ciphertext to Alice, and Alice applies her good matrix for error correction, so she can get correct all the errors, and if the errors are corrected, she receives the plaintext. This is how McAlice encryption works. And an attacker needs to find the error using a bad matrix, which is a lot more difficult than using Alice's public key. And which parameters are used in practice? Well, for example, this would be a typical value. 5,430 bits for the original message, quite long. With a matrix multiplication, we extend this to 6,960, and we have an overhead of 1,547 bit. We could correct 773 errors. This is not really necessary because in practice it's sufficient to have like 119 errors introduced, and all this results in a length of the public key of 1 megabyte. Well, now you might say 1 megabyte, that's pretty long for a public key, because as I said, RSA only needs about 2 kilobytes. So this is certainly a drawback of this encryption system, but it's quantum proof, or it's at least considered to be quantum proof, and it plays quite a role in this NIST competition. I think seven or eight of them are still in the race. Among them are McAllis, Spike, Rollo, and a few others. So, thanks for coming, Dr. Rocket Scientist, and now I'm going to introduce my last guest for today. My last guest is an island salesman. Well, I'm sure you all know a lot of island salesmen. It's a very interesting profession. Well, now what has happened? Recently Alice came to see this island salesman, and he asked her, "Do you want to buy an island?" And Alice said, "Yes, but I want to look at it first." So she took an airplane from her home city to the island. And she looked at this island, and then she took a decision, and then she wanted to tell the island salesman what her decision was, but it was a pretty bad connection, so it was only a few bits or maybe a few bytes could be transmitted. So in the first place, it was enough to transmit 1 bit, yes or no, and in theory, this scheme was sufficient, but well, both can cheat in this process. For example, Alice can say a yes and later say, "Well, I said a no." Or the island salesman can say, "I received a yes, although it was a no." So we need something like a digital signature scheme. And this can be done the following way. Before Alice leaves, she hands 2 safes to the island salesman. Each safe has a combination lock. And in the first safe, she puts a message saying, "Yes, I buy," signed by her. And the second safe contains a message saying, "No, I don't buy," also signed by her. And now when she has made her decision, she sends 1 of the 2 combinations to the island salesman. So either combination 1, then the salesman can open safe 1, and then he has a written statement in his hand saying, "Yes, I buy." And there's absolutely no way to deny it for Alice. And if she sends combination 2, there's also a written statement the island salesman receives. Again, it's signed and it says, "No, I don't buy." The combinations are Alice's private key. The public key is represented by these 2 safes and their content. And well, one disadvantage here is Alice needs to publish half of her private key, and this means the whole scheme can be only used once, and then new safes have to be used. But can we use this method digitally too? And the answer is yes. We need to replace the safes by a hashing function, for example, SHA-2. We need to replace the combinations as Alice's key with 2 random numbers, 1 and 2. We need Alice's public key now is not a set of safes anymore, but it's a set of 2 random numbers. The hash of the random numbers, sorry. And the signature is not the combination anymore. It's now the random number 1 or 2. And this is how it works in practice. Before Alice leaves, she doesn't give 2 safes to the salesman, but 2 hashes, the hash of random number 1, which represents yes, and the hash of random number 2, which represents a no. And when she has taken her decision, she sends either random number 1 or random number 2 to the salesman. And if it's random number 1, this is her private key and this is her public key. If it's random number 1, the salesman can easily check if he uses a hashing function if he really gets the hash of random number 2, and if it's correct, it's a yes. Or in the other case, he gets the hash of random number 2, and again, he can check if it's correct, and if this is the case, it represents a no. Again, Alice needs to publish half of her private key, and this scheme can only be used once with the same hashes and numbers. Now, this looks pretty laborious for only one bit, but, well, there are ways to improve this scheme, but basically it's always one of the inefficient schemes. So hash-based signatures are certainly not a first choice when it comes to digital signatures. But anyway, they are considered quite secure. They are even provably secure if one assumes that the hashing function cannot be broken. Well, hashing functions have been around for a while, so it's a safe assumption to believe that they are secure. So this is not the most efficient scheme in the world, but it's probably a pretty secure one. So we might see one of these in the near future being used in practice too. In the NIST competition, only one of these is still in the race. It's called Sphinx Plus. So thanks, Mr. Island Salesman. And we have looked at three of these families of quantum proof algorithms now. Let me now take a very brief look on the remaining ones. That's first the non-commutative algorithms. They can be explained with a Rubik's Cube. So with a Rubik's Cube or with some similar concept, Diffie-Hellman key exchange or something similar can be defined, and this is how non-commutative algorithms work. But in the NIST competition, there was only one that was submitted and it proved insecure. So in the second round, non-commutative algorithm is in the race anymore. So I'm pretty sure that we won't see any of these used in practice in the near future. There are also the so-called multivariate algorithms. They can be explained with the so-called ladder problem. The ladder problem is a very simple problem from elementary geometry. It's at least simple to explain, but very difficult to solve. And, well, time is too short to go into detail now, but in the competition, there are four of these algorithms still in the race, so it's well possible that one of them will be among the winners. And finally, there are the so-called isogeny-based algorithms. They are based on a maze, and this maze is defined with elliptic curves, so a very interesting way to define a crypto system. Again, it's about defining something like Diffie-Hellman, which is defined based on a path you take in this maze. Quite interesting, but the time is too short to go into detail now. And there is one isogeny-based algorithm that was handed in to the NIST competition, and it's still considered secure, so who knows? This also might be one of the winners. So let's summarize what we have seen. There are six families of crypto algorithms that are considered quantum proof. If we look at the NIST competition again, we see that 12 lattice-based encryption systems are still in the competition. So they make about almost half of the systems that are still considered secure. The coast-based systems are still in the race too. Seven of them are still considered secure. There are also four multivariate systems, and then we have one hash-based system, one isogeny-based, and one other. So this is the current state of the NIST quantum cryptography standardization competition, and I think in 1 or 2 years, or 3 years, about 5 or 6 of them shall be chosen, and they shall be standardized. So let's see what happens. So we'll certainly see some of these algorithms in practice. And apart from this, let's see what comes in the near future. Maybe next year I can tell you more about the NIST competition. And at the moment, all I can do is say, enjoy RSA 2020. Thank you.